All right, let's dive in. Today, we're basically going to be financial detectives. We're going to look right past the sticker price of a bond to figure out what it actually pays you. It's all about following the money to find the truth. So you see a bond out there says it has a 4% coupon, and you think, okay, cool, I'm going to earn 4%. But is that the whole story? Not even close. You know that coupon rate? It's really just one clue. The real return, the actual cash you'll pocket, is almost always a totally different number. So how in the world do we find it?
Well, we're going to solve this whole thing by cracking a case study. We're just going to follow the money step by step from the minute you invest to the very last payout. This isn't about some complex theory. It's just about the hard numbers.
Okay, so every good investigation has to start with the facts, right? Before we can calculate anything, we got to know the specifics of the bond we're looking at. Let's open up the case file. Here's our evidence. The bond's face value is 100. That's what it's worth at the very end. But here's the thing. We're buying it for 96.5, so we're getting it at a discount. The coupon rate is 4%, and that's the interest it pays. But here's the real twist in the case. The principal, our initial investment, isn't paid back all at once. Nope. This is an amortizing bond, which means we get a chunk of our principal back every single year for 4 years. And trust me, that changes everything.
First things first, we are going to map out every single dollar we expect to get before we even think about taxes. This is what's called the gross cash flow. It's the complete, unfiltered story of the bond's payments. Let's start building our timeline. At year zero, which is right now, we invest 96.5. That's cash going out, so we show it as a negative number. Simple. Then, because that 100 face value gets paid back in four equal chunks, we get 25 bucks back each year for the next 4 years. So far, so good. But where's the interest?
Okay, now for the interest payments. This is where it gets interesting. In year one, the full 100 of principal is still outstanding. So we get 4% of that, which is 4. But then we get that first 25 principal payment back, right? So now only 75 is left. In year two, the interest is 4% of 75, which is 3, and it just keeps shrinking every year as the principal gets paid down. This is absolutely key to understand. The interest payment is not some fixed amount.
So here it is, the full pre-tax picture. We've just added the principal and the interest together for each year. We pay out 96.5, and in return, we get this stream of payments, 29, then 28, 27, and finally 26. So now we have the complete cash flow. The big question is, what actual rate of return do all these payments represent?
To figure that out, we need this special tool called yield to maturity, or YTM for short. Think of it as the single number that gives you the true apples-to-apples return you're getting. It's basically the one magic interest rate that makes all those future payments, the 29, 28, 27, and 26, perfectly balance out with the 96.5 you invested today. It's the bond's hidden truth.
And when we run the numbers on that gross cash flow, the yield to maturity comes out to 5.56%. Now look at that. We started with a bond that had a 4% coupon rate, but because we got it at a discount and because of its funky payment structure, the actual pre-tax return is over 1.5% higher. That's huge. I mean, if you were just comparing coupons and saw another bond at 5%, you might have skipped this one. But the math shows this 4% bond is actually the better deal, at least before taxes. But we're not done yet.
Right. In the real world, you can never forget about taxes. And yep, bond interest is taxable. So for our next step, we have to figure out the net cash flow to find our real take-home return. So the rule for our case is pretty straightforward. There's a 25% tax, but it only hits the interest we earn each year. The principal repayment, that's just you getting your own money back, so it doesn't get taxed. Let's see how this plays out. In year one, we earned 4 in interest. 25% of that is 1, which goes to taxes. That leaves us with $3 in net interest. We add that to our 25 principal payment, and we get a total net cash flow of 28. We do that same calculation each year, and you can see our take-home pay gets a little smaller every single time. And now we run the yield to maturity calculation one last time, but on this new, smaller, after-tax cash flow. And what's the final answer? The real solution to the case? It's 4.53%. This is the number that really matters. It's the actual, spendable return on your investment after everyone's taken their cut.
So, after cracking this case, what's the big lesson here? Well, the most important takeaway is that the number you see on the front of the bond is rarely the number that actually ends up in your pocket.
Let's just put them side by side for a second. We started with a 4% coupon rate. Buying it at a discount shot the pre-tax yield all the way up to 5.56%. But then, after taxes took their bite, our true take-home yield landed at 4.53%. And that whole journey from 4% up to 5.56% and then back down to 4.53% is exactly why you have to do the math.
So if there is one thing you remember from all this, it's this. A bond's true yield isn't just one number. It's a dynamic result of three really key factors: the coupon it pays, the price you pay for it, and the specific way it pays you back over time. You change any one of those things, and you change your entire return. And the good news is you can do this for any bond just by following our four detective steps. First, map out every single cash flow. Second, calculate the total gross payments. Third, adjust those payments for taxes. And finally, calculate the yield on that net cash flow. That's it. That's the formula for finding the truth.
So we figured out the yield you'll get if you hold this bond all the way to the end. But what if you don't? What happens to your return if interest rates in the market change and you decide to sell this bond in, I don't know, 2 years? Well, that's a whole other investigation and a fantastic question to chew on.